Good morning. Welcome to Mulberry Street United Methodist Church. We're glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. We are a church on mission to share the heart of God from the heart of downtown Macon, and here's how you can be part of that mission. First, we're having our chili cook-off and apple pie contest. That'll be our second Sunday lunch for this month, immediately following worship next Sunday. There was much talk in the atrium as I was greeting people before Sunday school about how they were going to beat my chili. So I want you to know I'm bringing my A game. So I hope you're going to bring your A game, and we will have a great time of fellowshipping and enjoying some chili and apple pie next Sunday after worship. Second, Lent will be here before we know it. Lent begins on Wednesday, February 26th, right? And so that'll be here really soon. And again, just as we did during Advent, we'll have a common devotional so that you'll have the opportunity to read that devotional. It'll be daily. You'll hear sermons preached out of it as well. You see information in your bulletin about that. It's called Lent in Plain Sight by Jill Duffield. What I love about it is that she takes ordinary objects, coats, stones, and uses that to help us understand Lent in a different light. Elisa will also be using those objects as object lessons for the kids during the children's sermon. So I hope you'll get a copy of that. If you need the church office to help you locate a copy, let us know, but that is readily available on Amazon. Speaking of Lent, we've got a series of dates in the back of your bulletin for you to put on your calendar. Ash Wednesday, as I mentioned, is coming up on February 22nd. And then we'll have our daily Holy Week services again, starting Monday of Holy Week. And we have guest preachers preaching all of those. Names that you're familiar with, like Craig Hutto, our district superintendent, Jay Harris, the director of ministerial services, Ann Bossard, who did onboarding for us and works for the conference, the new chaplain at Wesleyan College, Rachel Hartman, and then a name that you are very familiar with, Katie Griffiths, will be preaching Good Friday. And so I hope you'll make plans to be here at noon every day of the week, Holy Week. We'll have a simple lunch to follow our roughly half an hour service. And then you see other dates there as well. So I hope you'll mark your calendar. We have a lot coming up here at Mulberry Street United Methodist Church. But for now, let us turn our minds and our attention and our hearts, all that we are and all that we have, to the worship of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. How beautiful are the places where you dwell, O Lord. This house cannot contain your glory. Even the heavens are bursting with the goodness of your presence. Happy are those who find their strength in you. Hear our prayers this day, Holy God, as we proclaim your praise to all the earth. And let us proclaim those praises by singing our first hymn of praise, number 126, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above. Please stand. Please remain standing as we affirm our faith together with the words of the Apostles' Creed, saying together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated. Thank you.
As we approach this time of preaching, let's pray together. Lord, take my lips and speak through them. Take our thoughts and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire for you. Unless you speak, nothing of significance will be spoken. Amen. Listening is powerful. I was unaware of that for much of my life. I wanted to talk. I wanted to tell people what was what. Years ago, I was walking down a street in Chattanooga with some friends and my girlfriend at the time, and I was busy telling them what was what, pontificating about something or other, talking, until suddenly I felt a violent yank as someone grabbed the back of me and pulled me backwards, right in time to feel the rush of wind from a city bus as it went right in front of me. I turned around to find my girlfriend looking terrified, screaming at me that they had been yelling at me to watch out for the bus, that I was about to walk right into the street in front of the bus. But I was so busy talking, I hadn't heard them, the desperate shouts of my friends, or anybody else for that matter, warning me I was about to walk in front of a bus. Listening is indeed powerful. And you would think I would have learned my lesson, but years later, I began working on that degree in counseling, and I was still not listening. As part of my training, we did mock counseling sessions, and rather than listen and empathize at first, I did most of the talking, and I told people how to fix their problems and what they were supposed to be feeling. It's ridiculous to say it out loud now, but for how many of us is the following true? We'd rather be heard than hear. We'd rather talk than listen. That includes listening to God. Sometimes in our prayer lives, it might be more tempting to talk to God than to listen to God. Certainly, we can have a lot we want to say to God, asking for help, for release from troubles, asking for good things to happen, praising God for who God is, and offering prayers of thanksgiving. We have much to say to God, but prayer also involves listening. So what does it mean to listen to God? That's where we turn in this sermon series on patience, how to listen to God in our lives, something that requires patience and attention. And we glean our lesson from the very famous story of the Tower of Babel from Genesis chapter 11. So let's hear that story now. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east, they came upon a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. And they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we shall be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which mortals had built. And the Lord said, "Look, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing that they propose to do now will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language there so that they will not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Genesis is full of etiologies. That's a fancy word that means stories of beginnings or stories of origins. This story is the etiology of where we get different nations and cultures and languages. The flood has happened not long before this. Noah has landed in safety, and his sons have begun to move out from where they landed and begin to repopulate the earth. So at this point, there are different tribes in a few different locations of the known world. But Genesis lets us know that everyone speaks the same language. So they get to a spot in a valley whose exact location is a matter of dispute, to build a city. The scripture says they had decided to build a city because they had decided to stop being nomads. 6,000 or so years ago, this was typical. Many nomadic tribes decided to settle down into cities at about that same moment. That's why historians often date the beginning of civilization to about 4,000 BC. But the problem here is not building a city, and the problem isn't even building a tower. That surprised me. I grew up thinking this story was about people trying to build a tower to reach to God. Maybe you did too. But when I went back and read it again, I discovered that wasn't the problem at all. If we look back at verse 4, we see that after saying they're going to build a city and a tower up to the heavens, which is really just their way of saying we're going to build a really tall skyscraper, they say, and let us make a name for ourselves. Why? So that they won't be scattered across the face of the earth. Turns out, they had not listened. The very first thing God commands of humans in Scripture, way back in Genesis 1, is to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The people at Babel decide to go against that commandment, staying put. Their expressed desire is not to fill the earth, but to fill this one spot they like. They are disobeying the very first commandment God ever gave humans. But okay, we might say, most of us like to be planted, to put down roots, to stay somewhere and build relationships and a life. That's what we tell people when they get married. Find somewhere you can put down roots. Several of us did that here in Macon and have been here quite a while, having established roots. We don't want to be scattered around. And there too, most of us live in this great city of Macon. We're city people. Cities are the lifeblood of our existence because cities provide necessary services and then, in our case, good recreational and entertainment opportunities. This story sounds anti-urban, anti-city. Must the commandment to be fruitful and fill the earth mean that all people are to live a nomadic existence? The people just want to build a city, have a reputation for themselves, settle down, make some roots, which is something most of us want. So what's the problem with wanting to make a name for yourself, for your city, for your church? We're dealing here in this story with leadership of a city that wants the best possible life for its citizens and to set a model for how to build a city. What is the problem with that? When God says that he will confuse the people so they cannot understand, the Hebrew word there is shema, a word that also means listen or hear. Shema also refers to the basic statement of principles and faith found in Torah in Deuteronomy 6. There it says, hear, or shema, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. You might recognize those words from Jesus, who, when he's asked what the greatest commandment is, quotes the Shema from Deuteronomy 6. The chief duty of the Israelites, and indeed of all of us who are the people of God, according to this first and greatest commandment, is to hear, to listen. Notice how the Shema opens. Hear. It's a command from God. Listen up. Hear me, God is saying through the Shema. And at the moment God establishes multiple languages, God says it will be so the people will be unable to listen to each other. The word in the Hebrew there in verse 7 is shema, so the people cannot listen to each other. It's like our former elementary school teachers would say, your ears don't work if your mouth is open. If you can't listen to those around you, and if you can't be heard by those around you as you talk, it becomes easier to listen to God. And so this story's point comes through loud and clear when we see God confusing the people so they cannot listen to each other. God wants us to listen to him first. The people of Babel had made many plans, executed those plans. They were a people of action. but they failed to listen to God first. We can make all the plans in the world, but if we are not listening to God in the midst of making those plans, they are bound to fail. That's certainly what happened with the folks at Babel. It's happened to me in my life more than once. It's easy to get wrapped up in making plans, moving and doing, and forget to listen to God, seeing what God is calling us to do next. Which begs the question from earlier, what does it mean to listen to God? Back when I was being taught how to practice counseling, I learned the practice of listening is very active. It's easy to think of listening as a passive thing, as if we just sit there and do nothing. But active listening, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, means paying very close attention to what is being said. It means listening not only to what's being said, but to what's not being said, what counseling calls listening around what the person is saying. It means remembering what's been said while also actively taking in what's currently being said. When we listen actively to all that's being said, we give listening to the other person our full attention. We don't let our minds wander. We don't think about what we're going to say next. We don't impatiently wait for our turn to talk, ready to respond before they're done talking. We actively take in the information being given to us and process it. The way to tell if someone has really listened to you is if there's a pause after you finish speaking. If they've really listened, they need that pause to process what you said before they can respond. Active listening is essential to proper conversation and also to our relationship with God. I first learned to actively listen to God through listening to the Holy Spirit through spiritual discipline as I was moving back into faith about 15 years ago. I find if I am regularly praying, I'm better acquainted with the Holy Spirit inside of me, who speaks to me and to all of us. And if I'm patient, not moving too quickly, listening to my soul, my family and close relationships, and most especially my prayer and scripture reading, I learn to hear the voice of God in the midst of the din of life. Actively listening to God means patiently, regularly engaging with spiritual discipline to learn to hear the voice of God through the Holy Spirit who lives inside of us. You may recall when I first came here, I held listening sessions. I listened at those sessions, and I listened to you in meetings and at onboarding and in other ways. That listening taught me much about this church, but I also began to have a sense of where God is moving and leading us, encouraging us to take that next faithful step. Through listening to you, coupled with my prayer life and reading of Scripture, I hear the voice of God speaking. Listening to God is different from listening to each other, but it still requires that we are quiet, patient, practicing active listening by reading Scripture and praying regularly and listening to each other. Listening closely to our children and parents, to our relatives and friends, to our fellow church members and co-workers, hearing how God is speaking through us, through Scripture, and through our prayer lives. As an example, I cannot tell you how many times I've been talking about something of some complexity with one of my children, and they have this special way of cutting through the complexity to give me a simple truth, and I hear the voice of God speaking even through them. At a basic level, listening to God means practicing the Shema. Hear, O people of God, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. If we are regularly engaged in spiritual discipline, in prayer especially, we will fall more and more in love with God and learn to discern His voice among all the noises in our lives. But of course, such discernment requires patience. The patience of waiting for God to speak. The patience of listening during times of silence. The patience of waiting to make decisions until we feel we have heard from God. The people at Babel missed that. They were too busy talking to listen. They were too busy being active to listen. They were just very simply too busy. The very first commandment ever given to humans is what they violated. Had they known Scripture, had they been listening, had they practiced Shema, they could have listened to God by hearing the voice of God through their conversations and their knowledge of Scripture, reminding them that God had called them not to fill this valley of Shinar, but to go and fill the earth. All of this requires patience, significant patience. It requires enduring, just as we've been talking about in the past three sermons, until we feel we have heard from God. It requires patience because active listening requires patience. To sit and really listen while someone talks, not impatiently waiting our turn to talk, not forming our response in our head while the other person is still talking, requires tremendous patience. It's not easy. In fact, even after all these years of practicing the skills I learned in counseling school, sometimes it's still hard for me. I'm a person of action. I'm decisive. I want to make moves and make things happen. But when I choose to act or embark on a plan without feeling that I have heard from God, when I make a decision and I don't feel that I've heard from God, that I've truly listened, it's impatience driving me, no matter how godly my plans or decision might be. Active listening requires patience, significant patience. It requires the patience to endure our own impatience while waiting to hear from God. Think back through decisions you've made where things did not go well. Think back through plans you've made that did not go as planned. With the benefit of hindsight, ask yourself what role impatience played. Impatience doesn't always make our plans go awry or cause poor decision-making, but as I did that exercise myself, I found it had a larger role to play than I might have expected. Impatience is me saying to God, I don't need you. I can do this on my own. That's because we decide that we can make plans independently of God. We decide that we know best how to act and when to act, just like the people at Babel. It's tempting to believe that we can do it on our own. I suspect many of you are like me, people of action, decisive, ready to make moves and get things done, but that's not God's way. God wants us to take a step back, survey the landscape, and above all, listen to God through our prayer lives, through our conversations with each other, and through reading and understanding Scripture. God does not want us to be ruled by our impatience. So when making plans or working through a decision, actively listening to God, what does that look like in practice? First, practice that form of examine that I've been talking about in the previous three sermons, asking yourself daily, what am I most grateful for today? What am I least grateful for today? It causes us to see where God is active in our lives, in the good things and the bad things. That's one way we listen. We see where God is moving in our lives. Second, we listen through regular spiritual discipline and practice. What are we hearing God speak to us through Scripture? Through regular quiet times? What are we hearing God say to us through our church attendance? Third, we listen through our lives. What are we hearing through our conversations with each other, especially with those whose faith we respect and whom we respect? Fourth and finally, we trust the Holy Spirit within us to help us discern the voice of God through all of the information and noise we take in. Through a peace that will dwell in our souls and through the grace of God that lives within and around us, we will be able to recognize the Holy Spirit pointing to the voice of God, helping us to listen if we choose patience, to rest in our decision making, to not rush things, being willing to wait until we feel that peace that we know is God speaking to us. The people in Babel did not listen to God. They were too busy making their own plans, guided by their own impatience. Let us not be like them. Let us listen to God, waiting until we feel we've heard from God to make our plans. Hear, Shema, O people of God, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Let us love God with all our hearts, with all our souls, and with all our strength by practicing spiritual discipline, including a robust prayer life. Listening is powerful. Active listening is particularly powerful, and we must apply it to our relationship with God, practicing patience, not allowing impatience to drive us to poor decisions and bad plans. So with Babel in mind, as you make plans and move and continue to be busy, the question before us is this: are you listening? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. As we approach the table today, we are mindful that one of the chief ways we experience God's grace in a powerful way is by receiving the elements here at this table. And because this is a table of Jesus Christ in the United Methodist Church, all, regardless of denominational affiliation or lack thereof, are welcome to come and receive here at this table. So hear these words of invitation. Christ our Lord invites to this his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please stand. Let's start over. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, our Alpha and our Omega, whose strong and loving arms encompass the universe. For with your eternal Word and Holy Spirit, you are forever one God. Through your Word, you created all things and called them good, and in you we live and move and have our being. When we fell into sin, you did not desert us. You made covenant with your people Israel and spoke to us through prophets and teachers. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, who called you Abba, Father. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you filled your people with a longing for a peace that would last and a justice that would never fail. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. And as the grain and the grapes once dispersed in the field are now united here on this table in bread and wine, so may we and all your people from every time and place be gathered into the unity of your eternal household and feast at your heavenly table forever. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Two little pieces. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself for us. Grant that we, by the strength of your Spirit, may go and give ourselves for others. In Christ's name, amen. Now I invite you to stand as we join in singing our final hymn. Now may the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Go in peace.